Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is the second day of November 2012. We're less than 5 days out now from the big election coming up next Tuesday. And it is quite a spectacle, even if you know, by and large, it is theater. Though it is true that Barack Obama wants to make churches pay for insurance that covers abortion. Whatever happened to separation of church and state? I'm going to break down what separation of church and state is a little bit here today. The federal government's trying to threaten Catholic churches, saying, hey, you don't criticize abortion now, and you're going to pay for it. I mean, they have no jurisdiction, but they've tricked churches into this. So I'm going to expose the giant hoax that is separation of church and state. Separation of church and state is real, but the definition that they have publicly sold is a complete fraud. So I will be getting to that. Look, talk about a delayed reaction. It's kind of like Force 10 from Navarone, where they detonate the dam and it doesn't collapse right away. It takes a few minutes. Sandy's worse than I thought it was going to be. I thought it was mainly hype, and they still did overhype it as the basically, this, you know, the storm of all time, you know, Satan incarnate ravaging the East Coast. But I was talking to David Ortiz just earlier. He was talking to friends and family on the East Coast, and they say it's scary. And so we're going to get maybe get David in here later to give us reports of friends and family he's got on the East Coast. And we also have Dan Bedondi out on the East Coast in Rhode Island. Who went back for a week to visit family, one of our reporters, so perhaps we'll get him to pop in. Joel Skousen is going to be with us for an hour and a half to give us his research into what really happened in the Benghazi raid. He thinks he's got the intel on what that whole soap opera is about. We've heard a lot of different conflicting ideas from Dr. Steve Pachinik, Webster Tarpley, many others, and I'm not saying their ideas couldn't be plausible. I don't think we have total proof of exactly what's happened yet. But it is important. He'll be joining us on that, then other geopolitical issues and basic preparedness. He was actually on the East Coast during the hurricane. Joel Skousen was. So that is coming up. We are also going to get to ex-Penn State president charged with perjury in Sandusky case. This actually happened while I was on the air yesterday, but I never got to it, but it dovetails a lot of important issues, so we're going to be breaking that down. And I saw a story out of Colorado. Now Kurt Nemo has actually written an article about it. Cops evict homeowner in Colorado. And they were in military uniforms and armored vehicles and things when they came, and it just shows that the difference between police and military is military is there to go after an enemy and kill people and break things. And the police are supposed to be guardians of the peace. And now police will tell you they're paramilitary. And the more and more of the population they're going to fight are going to be you, as the system raises taxes and regulations to the point of where it's impossible to keep your farm, your home, any of it. And the police all over the country even show up when the house is fraudulently being taken. And courts rule, hey, the banks can just take houses that aren't theirs. There's been a few cases, one in Florida famously a few years ago, where I think the headline was Cops Foreclose on Bank of America. We ought to pull that video up. I think it's still on YouTube, guys. I want to play that again. Cops Foreclose on Bank of America, because they took like $1.2 million paid for a decade before in cash. There was never a mortgage to any bank or Bank of America. It was paid in cash. And they just came and took it. And a year later, Bank of America wouldn't give them the house back and wouldn't give them the money. So finally, a judge said, go take the money out of the bank. And they sent the marshals over. But the point is they didn't send guys in military uniforms over. So we're going to be looking at that. We're going to be looking just at the police state on steroids as well today. It is all coming up. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Monday through Friday, from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m., Central Standard Time. We are here live, and we are launching another edition of the Alex Jones Show. I am Alex Jones, your host, Joel Skousen, expert on geopolitical activities, editor of World Affairs Brief, former Marine Corps fighter pilot in Vietnam, one of the leading world experts and best-selling authors of Strategic Relocation, the book, and The Secure Home, and also in the new film of the same name, Strategic Relocation, that we've just produced and released this week, available at InfowarsStore.com. He will be joining us for the last hour and a half of the broadcast today to give us his intel on what really happened in Benghazi, and then geopolitically what's happening in the economy, and your phone calls and more. I want to do this in the next hour and a half. I want to specifically open the phones up for people in New York, people in New Jersey, people in areas where the looting is increasing. They're talking about gas won't be there in many areas for another week, the power off for another 2 weeks. How are they going to have the election in 4 days? It's Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, 4 days, Tuesday. How are they going to have the election when large areas of the East Coast, they're talking about 4 to 6 million people still without power and probably without power next week? I want to hear from you with your eyewitness reports of what's happening in your area. Did you think the storm was hype? Or are we seeing it kind of as a delayed reaction? Because I had hoped that it wouldn't have been as bad as they were hyping. Sandy, starved New Yorkers, dumpster dive, NBC. We reported that yesterday. It's intensifying. Unrest growing among New Jersey, New York citizens, dumpster diving for food, fist fights over fuel, tempers flare in Sandy aftermath. And it is just a huge chronicle, Fox News reporting on that. This is a boil-down article that's excellent by Mike Adams up at Infowars.com, originating from naturalnews.com. We're going to be going over some of that. But there's looting. There's people getting mugged and beat up in massively increased numbers. And the media is trying to play it down. Anarchy along the Jersey Shore and on Long Island in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy. Michael Schneider, his economic collapse blog, breaks it down. 4.7 million homes and businesses that do not have power. Diving into dumpsters. They're saying the power could be off until November 11th. That's just some of the information there. Here's CNBC. Why East Coast gas stations may not, or why East Coast gas shortages may not end for a week. And it goes over the fact that supply lines are having big problems. Frustration at the pump reaches danger levels with fights and things breaking out. New York, New Jersey gas shortages, mile-long lines, rationing, fights, police draw guns. And quite a image of insanity that Breitbart has been able to collate together there. Staten Island borough president, don't give money to the Red Cross. Yeah, I've been saying that for a long time. I've seen Red Cross, United Way just do things that blow your mind. More than half the money they just completely keep. What they do is spend on PR. They have a lot of well-meaning people that volunteer for them, but that's just their front. I remember Oklahoma City. After that bombing, I think it was American Red Cross. It was American Red Cross. Was took over for the post office the checks and would take checks that were directly in the name of private individuals they saw on the news and deposited themselves. Guys, WorldNet Daily wrote about that, but so did the local news. But you guys type in, because I want to correct it if I'm wrong, going from deep memory here, like 15, 16 years ago. Search engine, American Red Cross kept Oklahoma City money. It's either them or United Way. The point is they all have been caught doing all sorts of terrible things. And, you know, I've done my own research. More than 90% of the money you give to things like Salvation Army actually goes to the ground to actually help people. The Red Cross is just basically a government globalist intelligence operation that they use to infiltrate countries. They use CIA spies within it. But we will go over that. Were you guys able to find that? Here, let me see if I can find it. Red Cross kept Oklahoma City bombing money. It drives me crazy when something's really, really old and I can't find it. The Raw story, investigation finds Red Cross agreed to withhold. That's from 2005. It's so old, it's hard to find. We'll look into it. Again, I'm not 100% sure on that. It's one of those two. The point is that you have to find, I guess, the exact headline when it's like 15 years old. I'll do it during the break. I obsess, kind of obsessive compulsive sometimes over information. Continuing here, New York City looters dressed like Con Edison workers to gain access to houses. And that's being reported by different East Coast papers. Staten Island residents plead for help from Mayor Bloomberg. Yeah, all he'll do is take your guns, folks. Continuing, 72 hours after grid down, starvation, supply shortages, food lines, no clean water, no gas, transportation are at standstill. Yeah, within 3 days, people start fighting and rioting without adequate food and water. Within 10 days, the Pentagon's done breakdowns in different countries watching this. Over 90% will start killing for food and water. And within 15 days, 90%+, depending on which study, it's right over 90, become cannibals. Within 15 days, the 9 out of 10 plus people will start eating others. Now, I mean, it's not going to get to that point, obviously, but notice this is happening in areas where you have people that are disarmed in these big mega cities that are death traps during disasters. I mean, if there was ever a big earthquake in L.A. or New York, a really big one, I mean, the system isn't going to be able to help you, and they aren't going to. They're going to come and take your guns because that is their goal. They'll put you in the Superdome for 6 days, sit on top of giant piles of food and water while you get raped inside. They will come to your high and dry home in the hills, you know, above New Orleans, and they will come noticing you have a generator, and they will steal it, and they will take your guns, and they will put you in jail, and they will knock your teeth out of you if you talk back. That's what happened. And they put it on the news like it was a good thing. The government is evil. The government is evil. Are there some National Guard people that, despite the corruption, you know, help some people? Yeah. In some areas of the country, are there good police forces that do help people? Yes. But in a disaster, the cops go home to take care of their families. And I just could not imagine living in a place where they've disarmed the people, like some of these mega cities we've got. I just can't believe it. So if they don't get the aid in, and if this continues like what we saw in New Orleans, but on a wider scale on the East Coast, it is going to be hellish. I want to give the number out and talk specifically to people that are in the storm-ravaged areas to give us your reports. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. And the websites are Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.tv, as well as PrisonPlanet.com. We are streaming video of the radio show at PrisonPlanet.tv and InfowarsNews.com. Both those addresses will get you there. And by the way, we're going to have extensive election night coverage during the day on the radio show. And then from 7 until past midnight, we're going to broadcast. So if you total it all up together, yeah, it's about 9 hours of broadcast that we're planning on Tuesday. 3 hours during the regular radio broadcast. We may even go 4 hours. So satellites transmit 4 hours of the show. And then we're going to do about 4 or 5 hours at night. So 8, 9 hours of transmission that we're going to have on the Tuesday of Election Day. And then Wednesday, November 7th in the aftermath, if there is any civil unrest or anything or any false flags, we're going to just be 24-7 covering. And that's why I've got 6 reporters on top of the other 3 reporters and all the other writers and researchers here at Infowars.com. Again, the toll-free number to join us is 1-800-259-9231. And yes, Rob Dew just corrected me. I don't have teleprompters or notes in front of me. I'm going to be on 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., probably later on the radio, and then we're going 5 to midnight or past that. So I guess it's more than 9 hours. I'm just, how many hours is that? Let me see, 5 to midnight or later. That's 7 hours right there, and then at least 3 hours is 10 hours. So there you go. Tell I went to public school, I can't even, probably need just a sheet on that stuff. I'm so flabbergasted by what's happening in the world economy and militarily. and the federal government telling churches you will pay for abortions, the confirmed fact that you will give your medical records to the IRS now. We're going to be getting to that. Federal courts saying we'll put cameras on your private property. We will cross no trespassing signs, and we will videotape you and your house and your family. You know, from any rural area, and you have no rights. Federal court ruling that. Federal courts ruling they will walk police dogs up to your front door and then claim that no warrant if they smell marijuana or explosives they're coming in. I mean, they're all dressed up and nobody to fight. And they got the tanks and the armored vehicles getting in place and all the guys coming back from Iraq and, you know, wherever. They do psychological testing. And if somebody thinks gun confiscation's good and thinks tyranny's good, hoorah, they're going into a big city police force and these giant SWAT teams. They're just expanding them into just brigades per state of paramilitary forces who sit in classes every week here in George Washington rundown, Second Amendment rundown, the family rundown. They're banning hugging and shaking hands in public schools worldwide. We just all are being inducted into a giant re-education camp. God help us. It's going to get a lot worse before it gets better. We'll come back with your phone call straight ahead from the hurricane-ravaged areas in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy. This is a song that Ben Bernanke loves. He covers himself with all of your stolen money that the IRS collects and sends directly to the private offshore Federal Reserve. But don't worry, girls all over the West are going into puberty at even age 3 now. Cancer is exploding, and they admit it's the plastic additives on purpose. But don't worry, in the United States, in Europe, and now in Australia, hugging is banned, jogging is banned. Everything will be banned. We are good little prisoners. We are absolute prisoners in this system. Ladies and gentlemen, we could not be here if it was not for you. Again, I just want to thank all of our listeners and supporters and station managers that carry the show. By the grace of God, our broadcast is exploding. And that's a good sign that, yes, as the tyranny increases, people are waking up. Okay, we're taking calls right now, so you can give us your eyewitness reports on what's happening, but the subways are still flooded, and I just cannot believe that so many people, I guess some of them had their houses totally destroyed, so I mean, what could they do? But a lot of people are on the news saying they tried to go to the grocery store that day, the day before it was hitting, to try to get food and toilet paper and weren't able to get it. I mean, I just do not understand not having, you know, your garage stuff full of stuff or whatever. I mean, even if you're poor, you can buy a few extra cans of, you know, food every week and try to pile it up. I mean, I was looking. I saw an article last week I didn't get to. I think it was McClatchy. Will you guys print it for me? It was Associated Press, too, I think, did one that the average household on welfare gets $60,000. Shoot, when I started making $60,000 a year, I thought I was rich. I mean, the people on welfare make $60,000 a year per household. Holy mackerel! Anyway, side issue. Let's go to your phone calls. John in New Jersey, where are you calling us from in New Jersey?
I'm actually up in northern New Jersey now. I evacuated Long Beach Island yesterday. I rode the storm out there, and reports aren't exaggerated, man. It is just total devastation, Armageddon down there. Just scary.
Yeah, that's where I saw, like, entire, you know, it's one solid, as you know, you live there, but I've driven through it, one solid tourist deal for everybody from New York and New Jersey. It's just solid little hotels and things, and they're, like, tumped over and smashed in the photos I've seen.
Yeah, I took a lot of photos. Like you said, it was kind of stupid. I was running out of water and food, but I had this morbid curiosity just to see what was going to happen and just to witness this thing, you know? The cops weren't too bad, but you could see they were getting off on it. You know, they were kicking people out of houses. They were geared up in their, you know, paramilitary gear almost, you know. They just didn't want to deal with anybody. I could kind of understand that, but you could tell some of these guys were really getting off on it.
Yeah, I mean, you know what? I'm not the toughest guy in the world, but I can stand up for myself, and I'm pretty confident. I would be embarrassed when I've seen police in some of these big cities, the way they act and strut around and are mean to people that haven't done anything. I mean, it's so, I mean, you're seeing all that that chicken walk behavior going on?
Yeah. I mean, there's really not too many people left there on the island. I mean, it was a mandatory evacuation, so they tried to get everybody off. I was actually escorted off by a friend who's a police officer. And, you know, he's a good guy, but he's just trying to do his job. But,
sure. I mean, that's one thing. I'm talking about, I thought you were implying people were, you know, really getting off on getting in people's faces. But I could also see the point of if they're saying mandatory evacuation. You know, my issue is if people want to stay and shelter in place, that should be their issue. I mean, I understand if a dam breaks, they could say it's a mandatory investigation. But just government has lost my trust, by and large. That's my issue.
Well, this is a vacation home, and I was taking care of it for my family. So I shut the water off, shut the gas off, power off. I did all I could do. And then I got out of there, and I went up to, I'm up in northern New Jersey now, and from all the way South Jersey up the parkway, mile-long, you know, traffic jams just to get gas at every rest stop. People walking on the parkway, walking across, trying to get gas with gas cans. I mean, if it doesn't get better, we're talking about bedlam soon up here in some of the urban areas. Down south, it's a little more close-knit community where I was just relying on friends, you know, to just, you know, to get food, to get water, and everybody kind of banded together. But up here, I mean, I think it's going to be, you know, every man for himself. And so,
well, that was my next question, but we're going to break. But I want to briefly ask you this when we come back, and we'll go to other calls. Talking to John in New Jersey, how bad is it going to get when the food and the water runs out? And the gas runs out. Live, ladies and gentlemen, we've got news on the economy, news on the Catholic Church and others being told to pay for abortions. Most churches are saluting and saying, well, if the government says so, we better do it, having no idea what the First Amendment is. In fact, guys, will you go get me one of the citizen rule books, please, that we put free in every order? Because I want to show people the evil First Amendment and explain what it is. This is not a mystery. But just like they can have the media announcing world government run by private megabanks all over the news, but then separately have the ADL and Southern Poverty Law Center come out and say that it doesn't exist. Isn't that interesting? It exists, but it doesn't exist. World government's good, but if you don't like it, you're insane and it doesn't exist. It's the same thing with the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. That's the separation of church and state. The government is not in the realm of the church. You can't charge them property taxes. You can't charge them taxes. You can't charge them anything. And until the 50s, that was the case in this country. And then they had the Rockefeller-funded World Council and National Council of Churches have the big denominations say, oh, we're becoming charitable organizations and stepping into government regulatory control. To the point of now, they'll send SWAT teams to churches that aren't 501c3 sometimes on the news and show preachers being arrested, running the hoax. It's illegal. And the cops are like the general public. They can't tie their shoelaces. And they really think it's illegal to not be under the government. When Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. That's why devil worshipers are allowed to chop open and eat goats. That's why Hopi Indians can take mescaline. But you, as a Christian, cannot be against abortion. You got that, Mac? So we're going to be going over that. I'm already starting to go over it, but we're going to get into it more. It's very important ahead of Joel Skousen joining us. Finishing up with John, then going to Gordon, Steve, Bob, Don, and others a little bit quicker. What do you expect to happen? You're saying you had to leave your place, devastated, mandatory evacuation, and you were starting to allude to things breaking down. There's already fistfights. Fuel running out, people dumpster diving within 24 hours, muggings, attacks. I mean, it's starting to really go south quick. It could be absolute bedlam by election time. What's your view on that?
Oh, yeah, no doubt. You know, where I am, it's a suburbia community up north here, and people are banding together. You know, they're sharing our resources, food and water, huddling together, you know, if you have power or a generator, stuff like that. You know, that's all well and good. That's to be expected in these type of areas. But when you get into Patterson, Newark, you know, things are just going to go bad, sour. If, you know, the major problem is gas. No one has gas. And, you know, it's just, I know people are siphoning, you know, gas out of cars and trucks wherever they can, you know, at night and stuff like that in certain, you know, other areas. We're just going to see how long it takes to get the power back on and get the pumps running, you know. And
if it takes a week or 10 days, like they're saying, do you think it's going to explode?
It could explode, like I said, in some of the, you know, crummier areas, for lack of a better word. The thing is, New Jersey has some of the strictest gun laws. And for the people that need them, it's hard for them to get them. And the people that don't need them have them. So,
that's right. And they throw the book at law-abiding people that break the law and get a gun for themselves to protect their family. Insane. I could not imagine living in a place where I don't have firearms. I mean, it's such a secure feeling to have a firearm right here underneath my desk. It is so secure at night to go to bed with my family that if anybody tried to attack my house, they're dead. I mean, you know, meet Mr. Semi-Auto Shotgun. God bless you, sir. Hope everything turns out up there okay. Wow. Gordon in New Jersey. A lot of calls from New Jersey. Go ahead, sir. You're on the air.
How you doing, Alex?
Good,
listen,
sir.
Listen, everything that they're saying about this hurricane, I just got my power back about 40 minutes ago.
Oh, good.
Everything they're saying about this is absolutely true. I don't know what they're saying on the media, because we've had no access to it since Monday when this thing started. But
well, you're
I can
saying
tell you
what you heard thing. Me. You're saying what you just heard me on the radio cover is true.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. As a matter of fact, all the law enforcement, you don't see anybody on the street. You see them all at the gas stations. They got several cars there with the lights flashing, people standing in line with gas cans. No cars are allowed in there with their gas cans for their generators, and they're just lined up. I mean, it's just like a waiting for something to happen with everybody there. And they're waiting there for hours, 3 hours. My next-door neighbor spent 3 hours trying to get gas.
Yeah, they're saying it could take, depending on the areas, 2 to 10 days for gas to get delivered. And they're talking about November 11th till the power's back in most areas. But I'm glad to hear you got your power back. Maybe those estimates are wrong.
Well, no, they're doing them like in 200, you know, like 200 houses at a time. All the businesses are right now dark. There's no way of getting food. They're letting you in there one at a time. That's also causing lines. One at a time, they're sitting there marking the prices on the things. We don't even know if the prices are right or not, whether they're gouging you for that. They're also they're only taking cash in these places because obviously they don't have the electric to do the credit cards and that. So we have, you know, I went to the bank to get cash. They're allowing one customer in at a time. They're only giving them $100 of their money, and that is it. You know, so this is going to break down soon because with all the people that are in line and people that are trying to get their money and the food and the water and the gas, I mean, it's getting down into 30 degrees right now in the evenings, and people are freezing in these houses, you know, with no
there you go. Every time there's a disaster, everybody just basically falls apart in these big cities, and then people in the country are fine. Because, well, I'm busy right now putting in a gas tank. I'm just going to start having fuel deliveries and gassing up at my house. Why not? I'm on a well and everything else, but I just feel for people that have been brought up totally under welfare or domesticated who are not going to have any idea what to do as the Depression incrementally rots things. God bless you, sir. Good to hear from you. Yeah, that is certainly what he's saying is backed up in the news reports. I saw where the welfare folks are really freaking out because they don't really have food stamps anymore. It's credit cards. And they let them get cash back so they can get liquor, cigarettes, things like that. And it's a giant, you know, the corporations like it because the 50 million people roughly on food stamps, they're in there at the grocery stores and everywhere else, you know, buying goods. And then everybody else subsidizes it. But then those people, it's get to where they don't know how to go get a job, basically. Plus, globalists have deindustrialized the country to a great extent, so it forces a lot of folks onto it, and then they get accustomed to it. So what's going to happen now that we're, 3 days into the welfare recipients? I have a couple articles here, mainstream news, saying that the welfare recipients cannot get anything because they have welfare cards. And again, they'll let them, on average, get about $50 out a day on that they normally use, you know, to buy other things that are prohibited. With a Lone Star card like we have here in Texas. They're called different things, different parts of the area. Let me just find that article. I actually have a couple articles on that instead of just mentioning it. It's important to actually find the article itself. Here's an important one. They're sending crews from Alabama and other states up there to try to get the power back on. But the unions that run these cities in New Jersey and New York, this is out of a News 48, WAFF, they're being turned back and told you can't help because you're non-union. The hurricane ravaged each coast will be receiving North Alabama help, but crews learned they'll be doing work in Long Island, New York, instead of New Jersey. Crews from Decatur Utilities headed up this week, but Derek Moore, one of Decatur workers, said they were told by crews in New Jersey that they can't do any work there since they're not union employees. Have you ever heard of getting the power back on so people don't freeze to death? I mean, the guys that aren't union are going to leave, and they're not going to be there during the emergency. I mean, they're not going to drive down. I guess you will get more work and get more pay. I guess it's all about money. So there you go. Just unbelievably disgusting. Local TSA workers headed to East Coast. Oh, they're headed to help with recovery efforts in Northeast, including some local federal employees. That's out of KSDK television. Can you imagine when the average TSA worker has their poison they're into? A lot of them want to rob drugs out of your suitcase because they're drug addicts. Schedule 3 narcotics and painkillers and sleeping pills. That's a huge epidemic on record. Or they're pedophiles who like to grab little kids. Or they're just bullies that like to dominate people. Or they're pervs that like good-looking women, and I've seen it. You see a good-looking woman coming through, you'll see a guy who's into that. He'll go, oh, and they'll all laugh, and he'll call them over, and it's on. These are weird, empty, powerless people that like to go around thugging all day. Just absolutely incredible. So local TSA workers headed to East Coast. Unbelievable. More St. Louisians, if that's how you say it, are headed into the destruction zone to help with recovery efforts in Northeast, including some local federal employees. TSA workers, well, they didn't call them agents, are leaving Thursday. Wow, an article that actually called them what they are. TSA workers are leaving Thursday. What they are is unbonded goons to help Sandy survivors. They're not only be helping the traveling public, but their fellow TSA screeners are dealing with the aftermath of the storm. And it goes on to say that's happening. So look out, ladies and gentlemen. Bacteria, sewage, and unknown contaminants in Sandy. Let me get to your calls here, but I do know that... here it is. Yeah, without electricity, New Yorkers on food stamps can't pay for food. It's been more than 3 days since power went on in many parts of New York, including the Lower East Side, where multi-story public housing complexes like the LaGuardia houses don't have electricity. For many of the residents are also without food because their electronic benefit cards aren't working. So we're going to be going over all of that as well. But let's hurry back to your calls for folks in storm-ravaged New York, New Jersey, and other areas calling. Steve in New York, what are you witnessing there? Are you in the state or the Big Apple?
I'm in Staten Island, the forgotten borough, the only conservative borough in the city, which is why we're neglected.
Yeah, I saw that Bloomberg's not sending help. But that's how it is. Republican states, whenever they have big wildfires, Obama won't send help.
Yeah, I mean, we come together here about half a mile away from me, just third world conditions. It's a complete disaster. Telling everybody listening, if you're on Staten Island, no one's going to help you. You have to help yourself. You got to get yourself together because waiting for the government to come and save you, it's just not going to happen. So.
Well, if it's like Katrina, it's going to be more than that. They might come pilfer your wife or rob your house.
Yeah, I mean, we're not allowed firearms here. So, we have the police circling all the neighborhoods and you look at them wrong, you're dead. So it's pretty bad here. It's, I don't know what to tell you. I mean, I have power. I'm basically in the middle of the island, but the rest of the island, most of it is just a complete third world situation. It's horrible.
And by third world, we're only 3 days into this. Most estimates by folks that studied demography and the different things that happen societally, I guess that's like mob psychology, say that if the power stays off a few more days and there's not adequate food and water, that it's going to be serious, uncontrolled rioting and looting will start. Because once people get hungry, they don't care if the cops are shooting at them.
Exactly, yes. It's you know, I'm hoping the power comes back, but like I said, the you know, to the rest of the island, but it's just a complete disaster.
Well, you know, if the looters really get going, what they'll do is, this has already happened in some areas, they'll set fires as distractions and then start looting, and the police will just stand down. I mean, what are the police doing there in Staten Island?
Patrolling all around. It's kind of like paramilitary force, you know, helicopters. And like I said, if you look at them the wrong way, if you go down to those areas, you know, you're either getting locked up or you're getting shot. So it's you know, there's no messing around with the, at least in the Staten Island police. They're pretty heavily armed, and they're taking care of all the riffraff that are crazy enough to try something. But like I said, you know, we can't really defend ourselves. We have to rely on them. So it's pretty dire straits. If it comes to the point where there's rioting and, you know, more unrest, we haven't had that much where I am. But you know, it's gonna get crazy unless they get the electric back up.
Yeah, I'm looking at different photos and videos from Staten Island of collapsed houses, streets blocked. I mean, what's it like there closer to the beach?
Everything's homes off that foundation. You know, one home is say a block away. Now it's five blocks into the inland. Just complete disaster. I mean, water rose up, you know, about a half a mile into the island around all sides, and all the people living there are just homeless now. And like I said, waiting for help, waiting for the government to help them. But you know, no one's going to help them. I mean, you know, we're banding together here, helping each other. But you know, just like I said, the mentality of trying to rely on government to save you, I mean, just not going to happen. I mean, this is just a lesson to be learned. That, you know, luckily I've been listening to your show for a long time. I'm a Prisonplanet TV subscriber. I'm aware of this stuff. But the people that are listening, if they just maybe not hip to this stuff, I mean, it's going to be. Yeah.
Sir, it was the same thing. I'm no rocket scientist, but we had the 2 or 3 days after 9/11, we had medical doctors on saying those are asbestos buildings. You know, there's 5-6 feet of dust. This is deadly. They're lying. It certainly is bad for people. And Christina Todd Whitman came out and said, it's good for you to breathe. And I said, look, don't give money to the Red Cross and United Way. Give it to local churches. And I said, mail respirators to them. I remember Mark Kornke also was the first I heard to point that out. And he was here on the Genesis Network at that time, the militia leader. And he said, we've absolutely got to get respirators. And we ran a program on air to try to get respirators up there. And again, the government knew that. If we knew that, they knew that. They were covering it up. They didn't even tell the people, hey, it's not safe, but if you got to come in, at least wear a mask. They let little kids 2 days later come back to school in the area. I mean, again, the government is run by the worst of the worst of the worst, total and complete sharks. And it is just absolutely off the chart what's going on. God bless you, sir, and I hope hope everything turns out okay there in New York. But, I mean, if it's bad now, what do you think it'll be like in 3 or 4 days if there's not food and water and gas and things?
It's going to be pretty bad. Yeah, it's going to be really bad. I mean, you know, it's basically, you know, we have a strong community, at least in this borough. So, you know, we're actually helping out each other. The churches are working together with the community, and everyone's helping out each other. But, you know, I could just imagine New Jersey you know, the areas really hit hard. I mean, that's like, you know, like basically all I can say is third world conditions probably for the next couple of years, at least where I am. And they're not going to rebuild. They're not going to save you. So,
yeah, the last hurricane, I was down in Galveston a few years ago before the big hurricane hit. I forget the name. And it tore it all up. And I mean, I've gone back down there like 3 years later. And it still tore up in a lot of areas. I mean, and that's a big tourist area where there's a ton of money from Houston coming in there. You know, hotel rooms down there in the middle of the summer are like $500 a night for not even a nice one. And they can hardly rebuild there. Can you imagine areas that were already depressed like Staten Island? Just amazing. God bless you, sir. And people say, well, why don't you get out of Staten Island or New York knowing this? Well, it's where people live. It's where their families have been for hundreds of years in some cases. Look at this. Round two. Forecasters predict nor'easter may hit East Coast Election Day. Another messy, wintry storm may cause post-Election Day problems for an already weather-weary East Coast, forecasters say. Meteorologists add that it's 6 days out, but that's rather early to get too worried. And again, it's November 2nd now. This came out last night, Fox News. I'm just now learning about that. There is so much to follow here. Look at this article. Every day without looking, I see multiple articles with TSA minions, working at different children's groups, being arrested for reported rapes of children. You've got the head of Penn State now being indicted for a conspiracy of silence, covering up abuse of kids. Penn State president charged with perjury in Sandusky case, a conspiracy of silence. Yeah, that was a film that was produced for Discovery Channel but never aired. And the makers of that in like 1997 sent it to me, and I put it on Access Television. That's the copy somebody else taped and put on the internet later about the Franklin cover-up and the politicians and the kids and the Boys Town and all the rest of it. People always send me emails or call and say, have you heard of Conspiracy of Silence? Yeah, I've heard of it. You better cover this. I'm like, I'm the one that put it out, but I didn't produce it. I was sent it and saw it and aired it and got death threats over it, by the way. I'm not bragging. I just hope people understand. I'm hanging out here, folks. I'm hanging way out on the edge, and there's all sorts of circus stuff going on behind the scenes trying to keep this from reaching you, but for every attack, the Lord just blesses us when we go through it. I mean, we are just gaining affiliates everywhere by the grace of God, and it feels so good to be able to warn people and let them know that, hey, flu shots give you the flu. Here's a document. Hey, read the insert. It says it can cause neurological disorders or death. Hey, your local newspaper says no flu shot side effects. Here's the CDC's own website. Let me read where it says it can kill you. I mean, I want to warn people. If I knew somebody was going in their backyard and a man-eating tiger was back there, I'd go tell my neighbor. It's just normal, everyday human behavior to be aware of this and want to warn people. And there are a lot of criminals out there that, you know, want to keep their good thing going. But it's gotten so big now. The good news is there are good guys and bad guys in government and corporations. And that's why every day I see multiple articles. I mean, here's another one. Homeland Security worker charged with soliciting kids on Facebook. Washington Examiner. I mean, it's multiple times daily. Who do you think wants to go get a uniform? Who do you think craves bossing people around all day? Either people who came out of cop families, they're out of the military, it's the best job they can get, they go and do it because they like excitement and going after bad guys. There's those types. But there's also the minority that's a large minority that like power because they're pieces of trash and they want to use undue power on you. And, I mean, folks, I've got like three articles today about federal workers and people being arrested for raping kids. I mean, who are these people? It's an army of scum. All right, I know we've got Bob in New Jersey. We've got Don in New York. We've got Josh in New Jersey. Sarah in New Jersey. Nick in New York. We're going to get to all of you real quick. I'll try to shut up, make your point, and I'll go to the next person. We're going to start the next hour in about... Well, there's a one-minute break coming up and 10-second ID, and we'll start the next hour. If you want to support us and support yourself, get Strategic Relocation, the book. It's full of diagrams, photos, maps. Joel Skousen, available at InfoWarsStore.com. And the new film, here it is, Strategic Relocation, the film with Alex Jones and Joel Skousen, along with the new film on fluoride in the water that's excellent, The Great Culling. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now into hour number two in 30 minutes. Joel Skousen of World Affairs Brief Editor will be joining us with breaking intel he's got on the Benghazi situation and a lot more. And, of course, we're covering election 2012. In fact, Rob Dew gave me the rundown here of Tuesday and Wednesday night. We're going to have a raft of special guests and on the audio feeds at Infowars.com and on the radio, but also at PrisonPlanet.tv, we're going to have a free video box for the entire election coverage. And I'll be here and have a raft of special guests. I'll tell you about that in the next segment. Right now, let's go back to the calls. Bob in New Jersey, thanks for holding and thanks for getting through. Bob, you've heard the other folks from New Jersey and New York say it's as bad or worse as what we're seeing on television. How bad is it in your area?
Well, Alex, I'm very fortunate. I live a bit inland from Atlantic City, and my power was out for about 18 hours, but restored.
Oh, good.
But what I'm observing is that the height of stupidity, as far as I'm concerned, is the fact that many of the storage facilities for oil, gas, and diesel fuel in Pennsylvania as well as in New Jersey don't have backup power in order to be able to pump their products in or out of the storage facilities. And in addition, many of the problems caused by the shortage of gasoline is not for the shortage of gasoline itself, but rather because in the state of New Jersey, there's no requirement for gas stations to have backup power.
Wow. Yeah, I saw some reports of that, and it looks like it's a chain reaction, and we've talked about that in preparedness so much, that the supply lines are so long, and everything now to have maximum profit is delivered as needed. No one stockpiles anything in corporations, businesses, that if you have any disruption, it can be catastrophic.
Well, that's a concept in business known as JIT, just-in-time.
Yeah.
Just-in-time inventories are great, except if there is any disruption in the supply chain, just as you said. And the reason that there's so much problems is because the product can't get distributed. In addition, all of these communities have in recent years set up these offices of emergency management, or also known as OEMs. And quite honestly, they don't have the proper protocols in place for even notifying the local press or the local radio stations as to what their procedures are in cases of emergency. And, on the island that is called Absecon Island, that consists of Atlantic City and a few other shore communities along the same island, they were allowing some people to leave. The residents would leave their homes on the island that had been, hit by the storm, and then the resident turns around and wants to get back in because they went to get a part for their heater or they went to get medication and so on and so forth, and then they turn around and go back, and they can't get back in because the police are blocking them from entrance. I mean, it's just totally absurd.
What is your view on the prognosis for New Jersey, New York, and other hard-hit areas? I mean, it looks like it's a slow burn, but things are starting to degenerate, and that power may not be back on in some areas until after Election Day. I mean, how is that going to affect the election? How is that going to affect other things?
Well, obviously, there's going to be some places where power is not restored prior to the election, and that's obviously going to cause, a very low turnout in certain areas. And it'll most likely be in the more urban centers where it's more difficult for them to restore power.
Yeah, and that'll hurt Obama. But a lot of experts have looked at it and said, well, it overall hurts Romney worse. Very interesting. Good thing they're both puppets anyway, so it's all academic. Stay with us. We'll be back. More calls and the First Amendment straight ahead. We are back live, ladies and gentlemen, and the mafia government is using the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy to call for more power for FEMA, even as FEMA is doing nothing but raising floodplain regulations, trying to make you buy insurance from the government, trying to run your life, confiscating your guns in Katrina. Truly disgusting. Aaron Dykes has a report that just went up at Infowars.com. As society unravels in the wake of Sandy, politicians endorse more power for FEMA. We're going to be getting into some of that. Also, I saw this yesterday, but I want to get more into it today. The little girl who reached puberty as young as 6, junk food, plastic packaging, and computer screens, could they be to blame? And they go on to admit the studies that it is to blame. This has been out for decades. They know this, but when I talk about it, they've had George Soros-affiliated media groups come out and just say that I'm attacking gay people. When the studies were saying that it confused the sexual organs and sexual endocrine hormone levels in rats. I mean, I'm just reading a study, but see, they want to all make it about, society is changing. Well, yeah, I mean, the fish are becoming bisexual. I mean, is that an obsession over sexual preference with fish and and frogs, amphibians, some crazy stuff going on. We're being manipulated. Fluoride, sodium fluoride, bisphenol A, aspartame. We're in a giant, giant laboratory situation here. Now, expanding on all of this, I also want to get into this report first after I take some calls. Then Joel Skousen, editor of World Affairs Brief, joining us on some important breaking geopolitical news, dealing with Benghazi and more coming up in about 25 minutes. But I want to get into McClatchy, Washington Bureau article. Bishop orders priest to read anti-Obama letter at Sunday sermons. We're going to be going over the real meaning of the First Amendment here in just a moment. But let's rush through some of your calls now for people that have been patiently holding. Don in New York, how bad is the aftermath of the storm with looting and robberies and the power being off and giant gas lines intensifying? I mean, if this continues, a lot of experts are saying it's going to degenerate the next few days. What can you tell us, Don?
Well, it was so nice to talk to you, Alex.
Thank you.
I'm in Long Island, and it's pretty bad here. I mean, down on the South Shore, it's like a total war zone. The National Guard's out there running around in their uniforms and their Humvees. I was online for gas last night for about 2 hours, and talk about people degenerating. I witnessed it firsthand last night. It was pretty scary.
What type of things did you witness, Don?
Oh, just people cutting and screaming and blowing their horns and cursing at everyone. And it was mayhem. It was just total mayhem. It's crazy. I mean, I'm fortunate enough to have power. I'm a small business owner here on the South Shore, so I'm seeing the devastation down along the South Shore, you know, firsthand here. So it's unbelievable. And then, they have these charging, government-funded charging stations where you could bring your cell phone there and charge your cell phone. Really? People can't even charge their own cell phones? It's unbelievable.
Where do you think it's going to go if the power stays off and people run out of food? I mean, there was dumpster diving within 24 hours. So many people, it appears, did not do any preparation.
I can't, no preparation. It's mind-boggling to me. I don't know. I mean, from what I witnessed last night at the gas station, and this was over gasoline, I can't even imagine, you know, what people are going to be like with food if it gets to that point.
Well, thank you for the call, and please stay in touch with us, Don. Thank you. Josh in New Jersey, also storm ravaged. We're getting reports there from listeners. If you just joined us on how bad it really is, eyewitness reports. Josh, what are you seeing?
Hey, Alex. Well, about 10 miles off the coast in Monmouth County, which got nailed, Belmar, Asbury. Basically, the shoreline's gone, you know. Everything's gone, as you can imagine, all the pictures. We're still out of power. The whole town, basically my whole county's out of power. Doesn't really make any sense. There's no answers for anything, and they were telling us ahead of time, 7 to 10 days, and they're kind of sticking to that. And a lot of areas seem to be shut down at the substation. So I'm not sure why they're making the problem worse for themselves. Doesn't make any sense.
Where do you think this whole situation is going?
Well, it's obviously going to get worse and worse and worse. I mean, we've been out 5 days, and it's interesting because a lot of people feel like it's going to come back any minute, and nobody's given any answers. Anybody on the radio that's from any kind of organization trying to help, they're really just not saying anything. There's no priority list.
What do you think of FEMA, as usual, saying they're the boss, but then not really coordinating, and then trying to block people from coming in to help? And then you've also got the unions trying to stop electricity repair crews from coming in from other states.
That's the interesting thing, Alex. I haven't seen any repair crews for days. I mean, nowhere. They just, every light's off. You see cops sitting there trying to still write people traffic tickets, which is just unbelievable.
Of course.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not even, you know, they're sitting there with their radars on. Unbelievable.
That's perfect. I mean, the country could be under nuclear attack and the cops would be writing tickets. Yeah.
No, to be honest, as soon as this happened, I wanted to call because I something's not right. And really, what I'm calling about is, what's the big picture here? What are they doing? What's the agenda? It's going to affect the election. you know, something's going on.
Did you know months ago, Dan Bedondi, when he was, I guess, flying back from being down here for a job interview, he's now been here, this was 3 months ago, but he's been down here now over a month. And it's on record on his blog talk show on YouTube, and we did a report on it last week. He also talked about it during the money bomb 2 weeks ago before this even started, the 48-hour broadcast. He was in an airport, and a guy recognized him, an Alex Jones listener, who was pretty senior mid-level FEMA. And the guy was showing him camps and saying there's going to be a big natural disaster, a storm is going to hit during the election, and they're telling us get ready for all this. And Bedondi, you know, was walking around the office telling me about it, and I heard him on, you know, during the 48-hour broadcast talk about it. I'm like, yeah, yeah, right. Even as the storm was forming. Now, maybe they just get FEMA ready every time for a power grab, but they have them ready for this federal rescue with 20,000 buses from other parts of the East Coast going into these areas. And we've had all the cops call in saying they said get ready for something huge late October, early November. It's going to, well, I mean, you saw the troops all over the East Coast and doing drills, and even in St. Louis and Missouri telling them, and the bullet buying. I don't know if this is the case. I'm just saying that is really scary that Bedondi, who doesn't run around saying a bunch of stuff like this, it'd be one thing if he was saying, you know, dozens of things, but then, I mean, I believe his story, and then it starts to come true, and then, I mean, I hope they get the power back on, and I hope this is a false alarm is my point.
Yeah, well, they're saying until next Wednesday, and I'll tell you right now, if that's true, it's going to be real bad. People here are not understanding. They're not going to be able to eat. They can't, you know, heat themselves. They have kids. It's going to be a nightmare. It's not going to get any better. And when they shut off substations and put entire towns in the dark, I'm not really sure why they're doing those things.
And they have the cops out writing tickets.
And then they're just sitting there, you know, waiting to scan you and see if, you know, you have a warrant out. I mean, it's just absurd.
Yeah.
I haven't seen, this is the county seat where I live, I haven't seen a single electric truck, nothing. I mean, maybe they're out, you know, where they need to be to make it all happen. But if you look at it, something's not right. Something is not right.
Well, that's what we're seeing, is it looks like it may be a partial stand down, kind of like the L.A. riots where the government invited what happened. And, wow, we're going to continue to track this. Thank you, Josh. Wow. Sarah in New Jersey, same state there, really ravaged. Where are you calling in New Jersey?
Can you hear me, Alex?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I'm calling from northern New Jersey. I work in Manhattan. I have several questions to ask you. Number one, I did a mail-in ballot, so I voted.
Good.
The National Guard, like, that's my biggest concern. They are bringing in the National Guard like there's no tomorrow.
Well, that's because they've disarmed the public in many areas of the country, so you don't have the normal, you know, citizens being armed to stop looting. And it's kind of like, you know, they take your immune system away to then put you on drugs. And that's kind of what's happening. But, I mean, in a way, if the National Guard wasn't there, it'd probably be a lot worse. But that, how long are they saying until the power's back on in your area?
I don't know. I'm like, I have power. I have everything.
Oh, good.
It's just, it's concerning me that I keep seeing National Guard on the news. When you look up here, you know how they have the little thing going across the bottom of the screen?
Yes, the ticker.
FEMA. Call 1-800-FEMA.
Yeah, everything in this country now is government's going to do it for you. Government welfare, government food stamps, government cards, government control, government. And the states, by and large, just don't even exist in many cases anymore. They're just subgroups of the federal government itself run by foreign banks. How bad do you think it will get in some areas of New York and New Jersey if they don't have power for another 8, 9, 10 days, like they're saying?
Exactly. They're saying not until my birthday. You're not going to have power. You're not going to have anything. What also upset me, Alex, was yesterday, I was going down the street just to go to Dunkin' Donuts and get some coffee. You can't do it because it's 3 stadium lines deep. But there was a guy walking down the street on his phone, and he was like, I haven't eaten in 2 days. And it's like, come on, you idiot. Like, everyone listening to your show, come on, you idiot. Like, get food. Like, make sure your family is taken care of.
Well, that's what I can't believe is some of the numbers I'm seeing, up to half the public made no preparations at all, and they had like 5 days of Frankenstorm news, end-of-the-world announcements. And then people ran out the last day to grab everything off the shelves. Incredible. All right, stay in touch with us, Sarah. I'm going to come back and get into the real meaning of the First Amendment because the government's taking the churches over completely right now. We're going to break this down straight ahead. We're going to shatter one of the biggest globalist hoaxes out there. Stay with us. Okay, folks, we are back. If you go to drudgereport.com, you can see the article that we put out this morning. Gun sales surge in fear of Obama re-election to an all-time new high. And I will be getting into some of that with Joel Skousen. That is a Paul Joseph Watson article. Firearms shop owner labels Obama the best gun salesman we've ever had. You know, I was having a talk with my wife this morning, and she's a really smart lady. And she said, look, Obama says he's going to make churches pay for abortions on their insurance for their employees. He says he's going to ban handguns and rifles. He says he's coming after them. I know Romney's New World Order, but, you know, maybe it was last night I was talking to her, but she's like, shouldn't you at least admit he, on the surface, says he's better? Because people aren't going to understand. You know, the average public's like, well, no, Romney says he's pro-gun and he's anti-abortion. They're not the same. They're backed by the same globalists, but they are not the same. And I just get a bad, immoral feeling not coming out and saying people should vote for Mitt Romney. I always just tell you what my gut feels like, what my heart feels like. Nevertheless, though, then I realize intellectually he's bought and paid for. It's the left-right paradigm. This is the trap where the Democrats just move you quicker towards the tyranny in one respect, but Republicans lead you towards tyranny faster in other areas. And then I think about how the Democratic Party groups are trying to shut us down with all sorts of dirty tricks that I don't even talk about on air. I'm so sick of them. And all they're going to make us do is work harder and expand. I'm not going to let these people shut us down. I think that's what Joseph Farah said to me on air and off air. He said, Alex, I know they do stuff to you. I know they mess with you. He goes, they mess with me. Don't you get it? They're coming after you like you are with the Republicans, even though you're not. And I guess that's kind of what it's like. It's like if there's some gang coming after me, because they see me as part of another gang, and I'm not part of the other gang, doesn't matter. I'm still in the gang. That's what the power structure does. They just put you in a gang, and then there's nothing you can do about it. Because I'm anti-abortion, ladies and gentlemen, and pro-gun, that's why they hate me. And I'm so sick of the New World Order. I am so sick of them, and I'm so sick of people that are dumbed down and don't know how evil the globalists are. I am so tired of it. Let me tell you something. If you're a new listener, the New World Order is real, Jack. Okay? I've had whoever it is listen to my phone lines before many times and call up and death threat me and tell me in a voice right out of a movie that they were just listening to what I was talking about with somebody on the phone. They've done it to my wife, too. And again, I don't say that to intimidate or scare you. I say that so you understand, folks, this thing is real. Okay? The New World Order is real. The additives they put in the food to make our girls go into puberty and to feminize our boys, that's all in the government documents, eco-science and other books, White House science czar. I mean, I understand why people think this some of this stuff couldn't be true, because reality is over the top. We got Joel Skousen coming up. This is a short segment. I'll have to get into the First Amendment first, but go ahead and get him on Skype and everything and get him lined up. We'll be doing Skype video, phone audio, because Skype doesn't have good audio for whatever reason, at least last time, but always riveting and informative. That's coming up. But it does shake me to my core that I don't have the oratory communication skills to really get across to people how real this is. I mean, there's a desperation that if I could just teach the general public what I've personally seen, what I've personally witnessed from government and the globalist, then you would know. I mean, if you knew what I knew, well, I guess someone cannot be told about the Matrix. One must see it for themselves. And you know, that's an allegory for life. I've chosen the red pill. And let me tell you, folks, taking the red pill is incredible. And it is a life-changing event to find reality, the door to reality, open the door, and then discover more and more and break through those boundaries and to learn how little you really do know. But then you look at the general public who has no idea But here's the mind trick. If you take the blue pill to live in the Matrix, all that evil's still there. Just now you are spiritually, physically, mentally blind to it. But you're so delusional, you don't even know when you're being destroyed. It's like you never see it coming. I want you to see it coming. We got to beat these people. We got to do it. Live for the balance of the broadcast, Joel Skousen, expert on disaster preparedness, strategic relocation, will be joining us. But he also writes the World Affairs Brief. And guys, I meant to print off his site, his Benghazi report that's just come out. Will you guys print that off the World Affairs Brief site for me as well? So that's coming up here in just a few minutes. I promised to do this, so I'm going to finish up on this attack on the First Amendment. We've mentioned it some, but now some of the churches are doing the right thing. The only thing. I'm going to briefly talk about that. But David Ortiz, we just took a bunch of calls. We'll be getting to more of them from Nick in New York, Bob in New York, Tommy in New York, Kirby in New York. So folks don't run up their phone bills. We might just get their numbers and then call them back or let them call back in. Leave the lines open for them later in the next hour with Joel Skousen because he's about to join us. But we've heard people calling in, the power out, their neighbors, being looted. All sorts of things are going on. People dumpster diving, large portions of the population not getting prepared. You've been down here for a few months now as an Infowars nightly news reporter, David, doing a great job. And we got some of your reports up on the site right now from just the last few days with Gary Johnson talking about the Bilderberg Group and the New World Order libertarian candidate. Pretty powerful. But tell us what your sister has been telling you and the reports you're getting from where, just from her neck of the woods where she lives.
Well, basically, Alex, you know, people in the New York, New Jersey area, they really don't cry wolf a lot. So when I started to get these texts over the past couple of days, they were pretty intense. You know, my sister sent me a text saying, David, this is scary, with an exclamation.
Yeah, you got notes there, what she said. Yeah.
Right. She sent me another text, and this is over the course of 2-3 days, 2 to 3.5 hour wait times. She sent me another text saying I couldn't back out without a cop's help, meaning that she was getting gas. And once she was done filling up the tank, things were so chaotic as she was backing out, the public wouldn't even let her reverse. So she needed the cop's help to really just get out of there. She says, no more than $30 worth of gas. That's the most you can get, and you need cash.
Look at how self-centered and lazy the average person is now. I mean, this is not the Depression generation who were 90% self-sufficient, roughly, and millions ended up starving to death one way or another, university studies show. Imagine if we ever have a real depression here, what it'll look like.
That's extremely, extremely scary. And right now, people are at the brink. Thank God there's little glimmers of hope, like lights and electricity are starting to, you know, be put up now. You know, some people have electricity. But people, you can hear it in their voice, their tonality. It's almost like they're starting to break, starting. So I'm happy to hear that a lot of people...
Within just 3 days.
Just takes 3 days.
Well, that's what all the studies in every culture show. 5 days, massive rioting, looting, and there's not food and water and power. 10 days, 90%+ of people will start killing and actually even invading areas where people are armed to get food. And within 15 days, over 90% become cannibals.
Yeah, absolutely. And another thing she's saying is that there's continual press conferences with Governor Chris Christie saying that gas stations can't price gouge, almost hinting that some gas stations are flirting with the idea.
Oh, it's obviously going on, but I've seen some reports of that. But that other point about not even AAA will come out and give you gas.
Yeah, basically AAA, whenever your car is in trouble, they always give you 2 gallons of free gasoline so that you can pull over to the local strip mall and then they could, you know, tow you.
Instead of just carrying a small can in your own car. Yeah,
I know. They don't even have that. AAA, you don't get free gas now. So the problem is a lot of people are running out of gas, waiting for gas on the gas line. And so now you've got some cars.
Well, a lot of areas won't even give cars gas. They're just giving it to people with cans for generators.
Right.
So I mean, talking to your family, if this keeps going another 3-4 days, is it going to blow sky high?
Oh, my God. Yeah, it's really concerning. People are breaking, too. My father, former military guy, he hasn't had heat for 3-4 days. He's now going to another family member's house because my mother just got a cold. The grandchildren are getting colds. So people are starting to break emotionally because they also don't have heat. It's not.
Wow, incredible, incredible. David Ortiz, thank you so much. We'll be covering this on Infowars Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. Look, I'm going to get to the First Amendment thing later in the next hour. I keep promising to do it, but then I just, I've got to segue into Joel Skousen because he's an expert on this subject, but I need to get into this First Amendment thing. I'll do it at the bottom of the hour next hour, I promise. I don't normally, you know, back things off. It's just that so much is happening. And this fight with the government takeover of churches, saying what they've got to do, you've got to pay for healthcare plans that have abortion. It is totally illegal because Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. That's the beginning of the First Amendment. So I'll just give you an addendum right now and then shift gears into what's happening on the East Coast. But in all orders of books, videos, the new film, Strategic Relocation with Joel Skousen, in all of the orders, you get a free citizen rule book with the Constitution, Bill of Rights, Declaration of Independence, and a lot more. Going over all this, but let me read you the First Amendment here. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Whenever you hear about free speech, it's about somebody's right to get taxpayer money to put a crucifix in a bowl of urine. You know, oh, they've got their right, but you're not going to criticize abortion in your church. They actually tell people in Baptist churches, Methodists now, when you have your First Amendment, government has no jurisdiction. That's what separation of church and state means. It doesn't mean that government then says churches can't have views on the world. And it goes on, or abridging the freedom of speech or the press or the right of the people to peaceably assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances. That's the First Amendment. And the point is that I'm a Protestant myself. That's what I've been raised as. But I've got to commend the Catholics for the Catholic bishops and people for coming out and saying, you don't tell us we've got to hire people who aren't our religion, A, and B, that in the churches, and that we've got to pay for abortions and their health care. We're not doing that. And Obama is evil. Okay? I mean, that's what they've come out. I've got the letter right here. It's in McClatchy News. And that's what the churches are supposed to do. Okay? This Romans 13 garbage, all of it. We're the people. The Bill of Rights and Constitution, Declaration of Independence, that is literally a sacred document based on common law, based on the Magna Carta, based on things that go back to Leviticus before it, and it's sacred. It's sacred, and that's what we render unto. That's our Caesar. But again, because just like the separation of church and state, Christ says, render unto Caesar things that are Caesar, things to God that are God's. The government has no jurisdiction in the religion. The two separate things. Two separate things. But then our government is based on that biblical system, which says you've got your free will. That's why you can go out and be a devil worshiper or an atheist or whatever you're into. But I got my right to say killing babies is wrong. You understand that? Now, I'm ranting, but that's basically it. I'll get more into it later. Joel Skousen, of course, is publisher of World Affairs Brief. He is also was a fighter pilot in the, with the Marines in the Vietnam era. He's also one of the leading experts on secure homes and preparedness. And he, of course, is the author of several books. In fact, I just had them in here. Oh, here they are over here. I had them up on the desk. Let me get them up here. Strategic Relocation. The third edition that is the basis of this new film that just came out. And it goes over in 2 hours and 40-something minutes with the expanded extras total, the whole thing that we're facing. The globalist takeover program, the three global power blocks, from Joel's deep research, what he thinks their program is to fully bring down the U.S. and then turn it into the new army of the world government, which Obama said our military is under U.N. NATO control. All of this is in the new film, Strategic Relocation. Strategic Relocation, the film, and it's going to. We have it in stock now. It starts shipping next week, so get your order in now. We can pretty much say now shipping for Strategic Relocation, and it integrates with these two books that we sell as well, The Secure Home by Joel Skousen, the Bible of just all the different variants from inexpensive to expensive ways to secure and also hide your home. Hide the secure areas of your home, and Strategic Relocation, which just isn't about running off to the hills. I mean, that's in there if you want to be in the safest place, but also if you live in big cities, the escape routes, basic preparedness, a map of all the countries with deep research on their scale of liberty and economic freedom. Truly an amazing book. All three of these are available discounted at InfoWarsStore.com. And again, I produced the film Strategic Relocation with the great crew, Rob Jacobson, and of course, Darren McBreen and many others that helped put this together. But amazing graphics, amazing research. This is invaluable. And I think every car should have strategic relocation in it because it's full of the water quality, nuclear plants, areas that can't be passed in bad weather, military bases, nuclear strike areas. And that's not why Joel Skousen is really joining us today. We'll talk more about it, some about it in the next hour. But I just wanted to get that plug in. This is available at InfoWarsStore.com or by calling 888-253-3139 or... You can also see it next Thursday. I don't want it to get conflicted with the election. So next Thursday was going to be Monday. We're going to premiere it at prisonplanet.tv for everyone and also integrate it in with the aftermath of the hurricane. All right, Joel Skousen joins us right now. Joel, before we get into Benghazi and geopolitical issues, you know, you were on the East Coast, I know, because I talked to you a few days ago as the hurricane hit. You were there, obviously, consulting, building secure homes and things. Every time I talk to you, you're somewhere else, globetrotting. You've lived in many of these countries around the world. So that's how you can speak about them and talk about them. But just looking at what we're seeing in New York and New Jersey predominantly, where most people just didn't even get prepared. They're just begging the government to help them. Staten Island in a collapse-type situation. It's just incredible to see how domesticated we've gotten. And you just heard David Ortiz there, sir, talking about you know, people not having power, people suddenly getting sick under stress. God forbid we go into a full collapse depression or any type of military attack on this country, because I think it's safe to say most of this country has now become fully domesticated.
Well, I was there, Alex, in the Albany, New York area, which was inland of the narrow strip of band, which was subject to the flooding and most of the high winds brought down the power in that narrow band around there. But it's interesting that even with, and because of that narrow band, I want to emphasize that there's not a huge area like Katrina that was destroyed or had a lot of destruction. This is a narrow band, and there's a widespread power outage because of the power lines going down. It was amazing. It was like a light show when you see the transformers explode and you see these blue and white, like fireworks going off underneath the clouds, as each of these power lines would short out and create the transforming problem. One of the biggest problems is the backing up of the sewers in that kind of a flooding where you have a lot of contamination, a lot of disease. Could be a problem if people aren't very, very careful. But the thing that I want to emphasize, it's kind of like I told you so in strategic relocation. I say, you know, the biggest problem isn't earthquake. The biggest problem isn't hurricanes or even nuclear war. The biggest problem is high-density population areas, because no matter what comes, it's the people that cannot and will not and do not prepare that are going to get deadly. And you may survive the terrorist attack. You may survive or not even be in a nuclear target area. And yet when people panic and go berserk, have no food and start to pillage, everything stops. Everything gets very, very dangerous to your life. And you know, even a handgun isn't going to protect you against huge mobs. You just can't go around, you know, defending yourself against those kinds of numbers. And that's why I say to people, you know, don't wait until this thing is bearing down upon you before you seek for relocation. And even those that people who can't get out of the New York metro area, you can relocate to areas that are less dense, that are more inland, but not sitting right on the beach where they're, you know, prime target for this.
Sure. Joel, just to interrupt again, I thought your Skype was good enough for radio. It's degraded a bit. The video is great, though, for PrisonPlanet.tv viewers. We're going to put you on the landline right now, so we'll go Skype video, phone audio right now with Joel Skousen. I want you to repeat everything you just said. It was pretty audible, but I want everybody to listen carefully. When you see the trailer for Strategic Relocation, you're only looking at the nuclear war aspect that Joel believes the globalists are gearing up for. And now we hear the Russians talking about nuclear war against us and stuff. I mean, we're in a more dangerous position now, the Pentagon says, than ever, even during the Cold War. That's not denied. But most of the book is just about other issues and the fact that when society breaks down, I mean, we see this slow depression happening and just the crime increases and the media just covers it up. So as all of this is expanding, I want him to repeat that for you, because that's the issue. It's what comes after. It's after the hurricane. It's after the earthquake. It's after the fires. And, you know, as the civilization gets, you know, more and more stressed, you're only going to see more of this type of thing unfold. And again, I don't know much compared to, say, my dad or my grandfather when it comes to farming, ranching, processing game. I know more than most of the public. And I am a novice when it comes to old timers. And I look at the general public. I mean, they literally do not know how to tie their shoelaces. And it's getting worse and worse. People are really good at watching television. People are really good at working the system. People are really good at all these type of things. Okay, Joel, start over where you said, because quite frankly, I want to cut a trailer out of this to promo the film, because it's so important. You're right. Start over with what you said about, I told you so. I mean, break that down, what the real danger is from disasters.
Yes, Alex, what I'm trying to say is that the biggest threat that we have is the high-density population centers that surround people who live in large metro areas. Despite the earthquakes, despite even nuclear war, if you're outside of a blast zone, it's the fact that the people around you cannot sustain themselves in high-density population areas without a continual stream of food, water, and government services. They're going to cause them to get into pillaging, and that can be hazardous to your health. You can't even defend yourself with multiple arms against mobs of people, and you wouldn't even want to. I mean, these people aren't necessarily evil. People simply panic because they haven't prepared and are starving to death and start to look for food or anything else that they can find. One of the things that I thought was interesting as well, Alex, is that people who thought that they could prepare in advance because they had warning, they had, you know, almost a week of warning the store was going. Within 3 days of going out to Home Depot and Lowe's and the other home improvement stores, the generators were gone. The gas cans were gone. The water supplies, even though there was still food in the supermarkets, the water supplies were gone from the supermarkets, and so were the batteries. And so a lot of people just don't think. They get narrow-minded about, well, batteries are going to be at this location. They fail to realize you go to a toy store, and they had all kinds of batteries. You go to a baby store, they had all kinds of batteries because nobody thought about going there. So, you know, people aren't very smart about dealing in a panic situation. They really, there's no substitute for preparation. And even when you prepare, you're not going to be able to get out there and interact with the people.
Exactly. Stay there. I want to get your take, Joel Skousen, one of the premier experts in preparedness, on where you see this East Coast degeneration going. In New York, one of our affiliates, 1310 AM, is on the air. We've had that affiliate for 14 years. I see Jason in New York holding, Nick in New York. I want to get to all of you, but we got our guest on late, but we're going to get to you. Joel Skousen of World Affairs Brief, the editor, joins us. The new film, Strategic Relocation. Folks, you just need to see the film to start thinking about preparedness and thinking about the different elements of it. Joel, I want to get into geopolitically some of the breaking news you have here today with Benghazi and where you see this election going. But you have this hurricane hit. We got another Blue Northern coming in about 4 days. They're talking about power out to millions until the 11th. If things are already degenerating, what do you expect to see happen? Because FEMA's already not there bringing food to people and stuff, and the Red Cross isn't helping. We've got people complaining about that. You know, my issue is people should be prepared themselves, unless they're the elderly or the infirm. What do you expect to happen?
Well, I want to reinforce what you're saying. There's no way that FEMA or the federal government or the state government can ever provide enough supplies to have people maintain a normal lifestyle in a crisis where major cutoff of electricity. You see, electricity is essential. You can't get gas at the stations that don't have electricity. You can't, get around, and many of the traffic lights don't work in these areas, so that the police are overwhelmed with that. I mean, it's just an incredibly difficult thing. Even though there's food, and you can truck in food, The stores don't have any way to refrigerate the stuff. They're not even taking delivery on stuff that they can't keep cold because the generators aren't big enough generally to run the big reefers and other things necessary. So if this lasts as long as to the 11th, now this isn't the end of the world, but believe me, there is going to be you're going to see some desperate people trying to get food, and it's going to be a problem if they don't have enough gas, if they're walking. I think you're going to see some pillaging in some areas. Police will be out in force, but this is going to be a real hardship on people. And hopefully it'll make believers of them, but historically speaking, it doesn't usually work that way. They forget after a year, and then they go back to their normal complacence.
Why is that? Because old-timers, statistically, I've seen the numbers, but I just know about my grandparents, especially the ones that live out in the country or lived out in the country. I mean, everybody had a few months of extra food and stuff put up. That's just what you did. Everybody had extra ammo. Everybody had extra cold weather stuff. Everybody, and everybody had, you know, things with their neighbors to help each other with fires or whatever. And then nowadays, not only do people not do it, it's demonized in the popular culture to be a prepper.
Well, a lot of people are so used to going almost daily shopping to the store and using most of their food out of the refrigerator. And that food now, after 3 days, is going bad. And that's the problem. They've got a few canned goods, but people are not used to making their own food or grinding their own wheat or having a slab of meat hanging in the back pantry like they had in the Depression days. And so we've really lost a lot of skills in that regard. So it's not going to be pretty for the people without power. Frankly, not all of the same millions without power are going to be without power. That's probably the last to pick up power. So as power fills in to these areas, you're going to find it easier for people to go to where there is power to get. So there probably is not going to be major social unrest, but it should be a wake-up call to everyone that you just don't want to be in a major big city
when
power goes out.
Next hour coming up, author, researcher, former Marine, naval aviator. We got to get you on sometime, Joel, just to tell some carrier landing stories at night. You've told me those privately. Pretty interesting. But we got more serious stuff to cover. We're going to come back and get into Benghazi, other geopolitical news, your phone calls, and a lot more. Joel Skousen of World Affairs Brief is our guest. I'm Alex Jones of Infowars. We're going to take a few calls in this segment, then get into his breaking Benghazi reports and information, what he thinks really happened there, where he thinks his election's going, talk of unrest, more on the hurricane and the aftermath. DrudgeReport.com's top link on the left-hand side to our story about record gun sales. But I want to just separately get Joel's points on a bunch of other issues, like the attack on churches, religion in this country. I mentioned that earlier. Makes my blood boil. But right now, let's go to Jason in New York, a 1310 AM WRSB. Again, that is probably one of our oldest affiliates since 1998. We had some before that, but those stations have been sold or changed names. The good old Dr. Wolf was the fellow that owned those stations, since passed away a long time ago. What a great guy, but we're still on those fine stations. Anyways, I always just reminisce because that's 1310 AM. It's like a member of the family. Jason, I guess the station's on. You've got power. I know that covers a couple cities. Are you in Rochester or Buffalo?
Rochester, Alex. How you doing?
Good, sir. What's on your mind today? How's it going up there?
Yeah, we didn't get hit hard at all. We're pretty good out this way. Nothing happened out the, you know, where I'm at.
Yeah, you're inland.
Yep. I'm about 20 minutes outside of Rochester. About an hour away from Syracuse.
Well, good to have you call in today. What's your take on the situation? Jason, I mean, what did you call in about?
Well, I'm off topic today. I was hoping to talk to you about the, Ron Paul sticker on my car got me into a whole bunch of trouble out where I'm at.
Oh, well, we can get Joel Skousen to comment on that. It's in official Homeland Security reports that I got and broke 3.5 years ago that is a sign of terrorism. If you support Chuck Baldwin, Ron Paul, or against the New World Order. Joel Skousen, comments on that.
Yeah, they have targeted them, you know, not necessarily as terrorists, but as potential domestic terrorists or people who are dissidents in government. Tell us what happened with your Ron Paul sticker.
Well, I was passing through the VA, Veterans Administration Hospital, where the Police said I was passing through there too many times. They're literally in my backyard. And they decided to pull me over. And I pulled over. And they decided to pull me out of my car when I asked them why they were pulling me over. And they said, well, you've came through here 8 times today. This is about 12 o'clock at night.
Did you explain you live there? Go ahead. So what happened?
Yeah, right. And, I had my... Unfortunately, I had some medicine with me, which I shouldn't have had, I guess. It was... I have back problems.
No, I understand. They turn anything into a crime. So what happened?
Well, I had a prescription for morphine. They emptied it into a bag and threw the bottle back in the car, charged me with having narcotics.
Well, all you got to do is bring in court. Don't settle. Go to court. They'll keep trying to get you to settle for lesser charge and show the prescription, and then you can go after them for false prosecution. But how did the Ron Paul thing come into it?
Well, I've seen them. Well, when they had me handcuffed, and after a while, I seen the one officer kept pounding his flashlight on the bumper sticker. I'm like, what's up with that? You know, he's like, you people make me sick. I'm like, you people, what do you mean? Never mind. And I had a don't tread on me bumper sticker.
Well, they've taught them you're a cop-killing terrorist. You know, I had a friend out in, I think it was Montana, a guy started a fight with him, started beating him up, so he pulled his pocket knife out and stabbed him, and they were going to charge him with all this stuff, and he just kept not plea bargaining. They dropped it. Sir, all you got to have is the doctor's prescription, the fact that they took it out and put it in the bag, put him on the stand. They'll never let it go to trial. Don't settle. That's what I do. We're going to come back with Joel Skousen. Stay with us. Yes, my friends, you have found us, the tip of the spear, the most successful anti-New World Order radio program in the world, and we're not bragging. We understand that is quite a responsibility. I hope you also realize that the globalists have done quite a lot to try to suppress this information over the last 50 years when people like Joel Skousen's uncle wrote The Naked Communist, trying to explain that ultra-rich were funding communism to shut down their competition. That's now, of course, an open secret that our government put Mao Zedong into power. That's even on History Channel with the old CIA section chiefs bragging about it, that Lenin and Stalin were put in power by the banksters in the U.S. and England. Hitler was financed by the globalist. Doesn't mean they fully controlled them. They just put them into power. Just unbelievable tyranny that we're facing. And the globalists wrap themselves in the American flag and try to take all of our liberties. Again, Joel Skousen is a best-selling author, researcher, the preeminent expert on secure homes, and lived all over the world. His book, Strategic Relocation, is the Bible when it comes to, well, North America is in great detail than other breakdowns of the rest of the world, safer countries if you do want to leave the United States, but also micro areas around cities, the escape routes in the biggest cities. It's invaluable. I mean, I have one in my truck when I go traveling, and it's right there because it's a roadmap and it's something I need. I've got copies at home, and I thought so much of it, I made a film. Strategic Relocation, Joel Skousen details the safest places to live and how to secure your home, and he breaks down country by country and region by region as well. It's almost 3 hours long, and it's got some info that's not in the book, and the book's got info that's not in the film, both of them available at InfoWarsStore.com or 888-253-3139, and the extras cover kind of a boil down of what's in his book, The Secure Home. So that's all available at InfoWarsStore.com or 888-253-3139. That's not the main reason he's here today. If you go over to his World Affairs brief, in fact, let's put that up on screen for viewers, and I'll give them the URL. Thank you, here in a moment. If you go to his World Affairs brief, he's got a new article out today where he looks at the Russian Navy conducts missile drills in the Pacific. Feds let Mexican cartel hitmen kill U.S. senior lawman. And that was even mainstream news a few days ago. He's got his boil down on that, folks. I haven't even covered that. In fact, will you guys reprint me that like AP article? Or you can print me the one Joel has up on his site. I mean, that's coming out now. I mean, we have a mafia government. And it's like the Texas State Police tried to stop the CPS from raping kids. The head of the DPS just got removed because of it a few years ago. You got the head of Penn State now being removed. for covering up mass rape of children. Folks, Sandusky was supplying them, just like the big BBC reporter Saville that's in so much trouble. And this is a cult of evil. But again, joelskousen.com will get you to World Affairs Brief as well. Joel Skousen, S-K-O-U-S-E-N. And again, we'll put his site back up on screen real quick. And we'll roll it down so we can see the URL up at the top for viewers there as well. That's joelskousen.com. What's the alternate site if people want to look it up, Joel?
Worldaffairsbrief.com.
That's right. I visit it all the time, but sometimes I got too much data to keep in my head or keep focused in the conscious area of the brain. Joel, geopolitically, break down your Benghazi breaking news and what you see happening in the election. Give us your breakdown on all of that right now.
Let me just say before I start there that people can get a free sample copy of today's World Affairs Brief by emailing me at editor@worldaffairsbrief.com. And it's going to be chock full of what we're talking about today, and people will especially want to read my election recommendations. As we've talked about, Alex, before on your show, I am not a believer that Romney is an insider. In fact, I'm sure he's not an insider. They don't let people on the inside who aren't grossly immoral, either heterosexually or homosexually, and cheat on their wives to show that they're otherwise blackmailable. But Romney has got this problem of, and it stems from the Mormon background of having a persecution complex, of being persecuted for so long. Have been called non-Christians. In fact, you know, you had Bill Schneebelin on, you know, ranting and raving about how evil Mormons are. Well, as a Mormon, you know, I take great umbrage at that. Most Mormons are extremely patriotic, very conservative, very dedicated Christians who really believe in Jesus, their Savior. And
yeah, well, just to be clear, Joel, I don't know who Bill Schneebelin is. We had a 48-hour you know, broadcast, and I don't want to create a big controversy over this, but I haven't seen what you're talking about, but I'll try to look into it. I was told we were doing a report on the history of Halloween was what I green-lighted for the reporters, but go ahead.
Well, I just got a lot of complaints from me about having this anti-Mormon rant on Alex Jones, and I said, well, I know Alex doesn't agree with that.
Yeah, well, I don't try to go around attacking, you know anybody. I mean, I'm trying to fight the New World Order, but yeah, I'll...
I understand, Alex.
But go ahead.
I understand. But I'm saying it's very important to understand, and this even affects a lot of fundamentalist Christians who feel like they're out of the mainstream, and so oftentimes you have big televangelists who are in the Christian community trying to kowtow to the White House and get on the prayer breakfast roll, trying to make the establishment recognize them, and it's just not good for religion. It hasn't been good for Mormonism to seek for the approval of the world. And so Mitt Romney thinks he's doing his church a favor, he's doing his family background a favor in the country by seeking to get the establishment to accept him. So he bends over backwards, he hires Chertoff and Associates to bring on the best and the brightest advisors. You know, it's a typical CEO weakness. When you're a big businessman, you hire the best and the brightest, you don't do your own thinking for you, other than your own, you know, financial business decisions, which he's very good at making. But, you know, he doesn't know anything about this New World Order. He doesn't know anything. And there's no excuse, because there's a lot of Mormons that do. The conservative constitution is full of Mormons who really understand this conspiracy issue. But he does not, because he wants to make it in the world. He doesn't want to know about it. And so he surrounds himself with globalist advisors and allows them to control his agenda. But the reason the powers that be have tried to stop Romney for so long, both in 2008, both in 2012, is because they are afraid of a non-insider, what they might see in the White House. A lot of black operations. If the Benghazi thing went down the way it went down with Barack Obama, who's a puppet, sure, Tom Donilon, who told him at 5 p.m. that day that the ambassador was in danger of being dead, and he was dead a couple of hours.
Yeah, let's stop right there and go over your report, because I've been looking at this, and I've seen reports of it's a false flag, you know, to blame Obama, but then I haven't really seen the evidence of that. But then now in hindsight, you look at it, it looks like the al-Qaeda groups that they put in charge of Benghazi, who were charged with security overall, their subgroup are the ones that attacked, and then why Obama would deny help to sabotage himself. I mean, I've really tried to figure out what was happening. From your research, what really happened?
Well, in the first place, Obama had nothing to do with it. Obama's a puppet sitting there. This was done by typical black operations. In my opinion, now, let's go through the issue. First of all, this was not a consulate. This was not an embassy. This was a compound. Had a couple of warehouses associated with this compound.
Like a safe house.
No, well, not a safe house.
A compound.
What they would call a mission, meaning a small compound, temporary building.
A substation.
Couple of warehouses associated with chock full of weapons that they had collected from Gaddafi when they took over. And a lot of these had been stockpiled, not by any U.S. troops or anything. They'd been stockpiled by various militias. But what was happening is that the U.S. was starting to sell off the stockpile or give it away to jihadists who were involved in the Syrian opposition, and they were using Turkey as the channel for this. Well, there was obviously a competition between several of these al-Qaeda and jihadist groups, Muslim Brotherhood included, in the area, and the Benghazi people, you know, wanted those weapons. And that's why the attack went down, to take the weapons and keep the United States from shipping them off to other groups. But in the process, this does not explain why the ambassador was allowed to be killed. This was clearly a stand-down order. This was not something where, as many neocon advisors to the president, who, you know, the president isn't talking, the media isn't talking about what went on here, but alternate media of the left and the right and the neocons is exchanging information about this. And the standard story of the neocons supporting this operation is that they wanted to simply not antagonize Muslims, so they're going to let American die rather than directly attack these insurgents, which they had been supporting. This really doesn't hold water, because you could have come in and inserted troops and things. They had plenty of time. This took several hours to go down. You could have inserted, you could have driven off the things and held a truce and sorted it out. They purposely let this ambassador die. And unfortunately, three other Americans, two Navy SEALs who had disobeyed orders to go in and save the ambassador, plus another techie guy that was there. But what I also found out is there were five security people with the ambassador there, and they abandoned him, and they all survived. Now, that's against all the protocols of people who are tasked, whether it's Marines or CIA, and this was CIA, people to protect the ambassador. They abandoned him. That's the only way that they all survive.
Well, that's the thing. They say that some say this is a false flag, tarpley, and others, and I've heard them out. I don't know what the truth is perfectly. I'm trying to figure it out. They say it was a false flag to make Obama look bad, but Obama and his people, you know, his apparatus was in command. They're the ones that denied the help, not the neocons.
Well, let me put it this way. It was the dark side of government in command of this. Obama wasn't in command. Obama didn't give any orders. He was simply told what was going down.
So why did the dark side do this?
Well, let me put it this way. Tarpley's wrong on this, in my opinion. This was not meant to take Obama down, because the dark side of government has an intrinsic relationship with the media. If there was a thing to undo Obama, to take him down, make him look bad, and accrue to Romney, the media would have followed up.
Sure. No, clearly the media was on the side of this, and they're allied with dark side. Stay there. Well, let's see who you think's really behind this and what's at the bottom of it. Alex Jones here with a very important announcement for truth. All right, Joel Skousen, a former Marine Corps naval aviator in Vietnam, author, researcher. He's in our new film, Strategic Relocation, that integrates with the book, Strategic Relocation, all available at InfoWarsStore.com. And everyone needs this. Or let's say you're already prepared. Give it as a gift this Christmas. Give it to your friends and family. Also give gift subscriptions, 12 issues of InfoWars magazine. When we have back issues, we'll stick some of those in too, when supplies allow. So you probably get more in their first shipment. A big color, nice magazine covering all these issues. 12 of them delivered to their door. If that won't wake somebody up, nothing will. So we're going back to print as everybody else gets out of it, and it's having a huge effect. The 1776 pamphleteers. And as they move in the internet kill switch more and more, it's important to build up our print presence, part of our preparedness to continue to get the word out. Oh, also, we're going to email it out today at about 5 o'clock, the digital version. If you want a free digital version of InfoWars magazine, you can go to InfoWars.com/newsletter and just sign up with your email, and we will send you a digital copy. We can click on the links and so much more. Very interactive. Infowars.com/newsletter. Okay, Joel, this is a short segment, long segment coming up. But okay, so you're breaking down all the facts. Who do you think was behind it then?
Well, this was, in fact, a hit on an elimination of someone who I believe was getting cold feet. There's a lot of pressure on the government. The government's in denial that they are even supplying arms to the Syrian opposition. That's a lie. Christopher Stevens, the ambassador, knew it was a lie. I think he was getting cold feet, and that's what happens. Look what happened to these two generals who argued with the Pentagon. They did not want to stand down. They had live feed. They knew what was going down at that compound, and that an ambassador's life was at stake. The two Navy SEALs were there trying to fight. At five CA security men were there. They wanted to go in with Delta Team. So the admiral.
Well, that's right. Let's be clear. The SEALs were almost a mile away and ran there when nobody would help them. They were there attached to CIA and just basically refused to stand down.
That's correct. And but what I'm saying is that they had a laser designator with them. That means that they had an armed drone overhead, according to Claire Lopez, former CIA, and either that or an AC-130 gunship up there that was going to devastate, you know, this opposition. And they were told to stand down. Now, that stand down order had to be heard by General Hall and Admiral Goyette, who were on these communications wires, these satellite communications things, and they went hopping mad to the Pentagon, apparently, and they were both relieved on the spot because of bucking what was going on.
And that's right. Nobody's putting this together, but as you put it together, I've seen all these articles, but they never tell you what you're looking at, and now they're trying to trump stuff up on them. So again, you've got an arms cache by the local Al-Qaeda security force that's under that command. He gets cold feet, so they send in the Al-Qaeda force to kill their own people, basically, because the ambassador wasn't going to go along with giving missiles to Al-Qaeda.
That's right. And it wasn't that he, you know, he had gone along before, so I have to estimate that this was getting cold feet. This is not the first shipment that's been made out of Benghazi.
To Syria.
Yeah, that's right, from Benghazi to Syria through Turkey. And it was clearly an attempt to clean out the situation and make it go away. That's why the entire warehouses have been emptied now. The operation is done. But, you know, they didn't just clean out an ambassador who knew too much and to silence him in that sense, because, you know, they use these people who ambassadorial diplomatic position to our CIA. Christopher Stevens was CIA, you know, he was an ambassador. Happens all the time. My wife was married to a diplomat in Athens, and he turned out to be, I'm sorry, not my wife, but my mother, and he turned out to be CIA. She ended up divorcing after finding that out. But they use black operations all the time, and they don't get rid of them unless they get cold feet. You read Rodney Stitch's book, Defrauding America. It's full of whistleblower accounts of people who got cold feet, started to buck black operations, and they ended up in prison or dead. And that's what happened here, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, people say, like you've said, once CIA, always CIA. That's not true. Actually, from what I've researched, the majority finally get given jobs evil enough, they say no, and they just set them up, kill them, or, you know, run them to ground. And that's why this evil keeps winning. It can just go through as many cops, TSA, FBI, Army, whatever they need to find enough dark side operatives to put them into those power ranks.
That's right. Now, going back to my original segue into this, this is the reason they're afraid of having somebody like Romney in. If you're not an outright puppet like Obama or George Bush was, and you're somebody who really thinks he's president, if Romney wins this election and sees an operation like
this. Stay there. We got to go to break. Tell us about that when we come back.
We're on
Monday through Friday from 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern. That's what, 9 a.m. to noon Pacific. We're here blasting out worldwide. All I want is liberty and freedom and transparency in my constitutional republic. I believe we're a nation state and a republic, not a globalist empire. I want to see 1776 worldwide. I want to see freedom worldwide, not authoritarianism. And the whole world is marching towards authoritarianism. There's different power blocks, but they all grab the latest technologies of control. And as the public becomes more and more domesticated, things are getting worse and worse. Joel Skousen of worldaffairsbrief.com, joins us again. I'm Alex Jones of Infowars.com. The new film is out, Strategic Relocation, breaking down not just where to move, but micro regions in your area. So impressed with Joel Skousen because, you know, I've interviewed him many times over the last 14, 15 years. I've been interviewing him, I guess, since about 98 or so. Been on the air since 96. But actually reading Strategic Relocation, second edition, before the third came out, because I was looking at where to move outside Austin, I'd already pretty much chosen this area of the hill country. It wasn't perfect. It gets better further out, safety-wise, but it was still, you know, a lot better. More informed people, more prepared people, a lot of other folks that have moved out, you know, knowing what's going on. And then talking to Joel in person, but also off, you know, off air, and when he came to Austin, he just knew so much about the hill country that I'd grown up in and around. I grew up in Dallas-Fort Worth area, but also had family down in Austin, so spent a lot of time in the hill country and been here since high school. And just amazing. And then other spots of the country I've been to and know about, he knew all about them. And things I'd learned about certain cultures and groups in certain areas, he knew. I mean, real research. And so he's focused on this. I haven't focused on it, so he knows a lot more than I do. I just spot-checked a lot of it and found it to be really accurate information. So I hope you get the film. Because it's got escape routes in your city. It's got countries rated on their economic freedom, political freedom. You know, if you choose to leave the country, Joel doesn't really overall recommend that. Perhaps we can talk some about preparedness before he leaves us. Now, there's people been holding a while that I guess they've chosen to hold, but I'll try to get to them for their reports from the East Coast. But Joel, finishing up with the whole Benghazi situation, what does it signify that they did this and thought they could get away with it? I mean, I know they can sell snow cones to Eskimos, the way the public's dumbed down. But looking at this, they publicly run Al-Qaeda against Libya, engage in ethnic cleansing of the blacks, call it a peace operation. Then they start attacking a year ago Syria, who I'm no fan of, but compared to Al-Qaeda, Assad's a really nice guy. Saudi Arabia's backing all this. They're running around like madmen. They're trying to get a Shiite-Sunni war going. There's 10,000 missiles missing, 2,000 of them heat-seeking or radar-guided. I mean, you're a former naval aviator. You can break that down for us. But I've talked to Air Force folks confirming that. But it's been in the news. And that's not an issue. PSA needs to, you know, grope everybody and teach us we're Al-Qaeda and have highway checkpoints. But the government runs Al-Qaeda. And then they admit this was the main security force over Benghazi that the West had put in out of Libya, into eastern Libya to first launch the civil war a year and a half ago. And then it was this group that goes in and kills him. And then they say, oh, it was just a protest that got out of control. And I mean, what really happened? How is it going for him? What do you see happening in the election?
Well, they have to keep this phony war on terror going. And that's the reason I believe that the powers that be hired some really second-rate guys to produce this video. Hardly got shown in the United States. It was specifically made to be shipped overseas and given to higher-end Al-Qaeda people who went around showing it to Muslim groups to get them all riled up to go attack various embassies. But this is more political theater, essentially, to keep the American people believing. This dovetails with things like Glenn Beck's The Project. This is a propaganda outfit. I'm not claiming that Glenn Beck understands this, but he got this information from a government who said they got it out of Switzerland, just hyping the Muslim Brotherhood threat. It is hype. Almost everybody in the who's made anything in the Muslim Brotherhood or these pro-Islam type of foundations in the United States are run by the United States government. They're the ones that supply them. They're the ones that help them out. They do not intend to let the Muslim Brotherhood or the Al-Qaeda people take over the United States. The documentary, The Project, is a lot of fraud in it, stuff comparing it to infiltration with the Marxists. Not going to happen. They have a cultural and racial different look. You cannot infiltrate Caucasian society without being very, very noticeable. The only way that they're able to even immigrate into Europe and the United States because our government lets them in for crisis creation, for conflict creation purposes. But it's not that they allow them to take over. It's not going to be an Ottoman Empire threat. It's not a threat to our civilization. They want it to simply continue to drive the war on terror. It's being very, very successful. And a lot of dumb conservatives are falling into this trap, promoting this Muslim Brotherhood hype, saying that this is the issue. The issue isn't that. It's our own government creating conflict, setting us up for wars. There's going to be a war in the Middle East. The reason that the war on Iran has been postponed almost 6 months, could be anywhere from 3 to 6 months, is specifically because Syria's been a hard nut to crack. They have to get rid of Syria before they attack Iran in order to diminish the threat of retaliation. Syria has far more retaliatory capacity than Iran does on Israel, and they're much closer. Their non-guided missiles can make, you know, play havoc in Israel. Hezbollah's got about 1,000 smaller missiles, can't do a lot of damage, but Syria can. And that's why Syria has to be removed. That's why all the stops were pulled out to be able to move this equipment in, and that's why they've hired every al-Qaeda, every terrorist they can in the Middle East to go fight against Syria. And, you know, Turkey is taking advantage of what I think are false flag mortar attacks onto the Syrian side of the border so that Syria can double up or triple up on the retaliation they're going against Syria. I think they're trying to provoke Syria into an armed response to Turkey that will justify NATO coming in, because, frankly, the Syrian, Free Syrian Army and the other al-Qaeda types in there are not making headway. They're not going to be able to beat Syria until NATO starts a no-fly zone, which, as you and I know, is much more than a no-fly zone, until they send special forces in there to undermine what's going on.
Well, yeah, they call it a no-fly zone and they start bombing any military equipment. I want to get in briefly to the master plan for the Middle East. Obviously, they need to take out Syria, as you said, before Iran. So this does show they are planning something militarily, at least for the possibility of that, is why they admit they want to get rid of that. It's what Wesley Clark talked about, the eight nations that they want to take down. But, you know, when we say 9/11 is an inside job, that's not saying the firefighters were in there with plungers blowing it up, or that the average military person's involved. It's the criminal globalist network that's been caught staging Fast and Furious, that's been caught staging Oklahoma City, that's been caught staging so many things to radically change our republic into a tyranny in the name of safety. But if this doesn't prove 9/11 is an inside job, that they use al-Qaeda against the Russians in the 80s, they use them against the Serbs. When the Serbs respond, they call them terrorists and go remove them. I'm not siding with the Serbs. The point is that's an ethnic, you know, a religious conflict, and the West is stirring it up so that NATO and Europe can get rid of those sovereign countries in the Balkans and change it. And now here's our criminal government siding with al-Qaeda. It shows the ultimate disdain for the public that they're saying, with one hand, al-Qaeda is the greatest threat, give your rights up for it, while the manuals actually say Homeland Security is for conservatives and libertarians and gun owners and Amish and Mormons, for that matter, anybody who wants to be, you know, self-sufficient, Christians, you know, homeschoolers, Ron Paul type folks, patriots, I mean, preppers. I mean, this is so out in the open. What is their master plan, and how does this tie into al-Qaeda being a tool of the globalist?
The master plan, Alex, is antagonizing the two major ethnic groups that support Russia and China. Russia and China is the ultimate goal to get them to strike the West, and I'll get into that at the end of this. But the two major ethnic groups that are responsible or that are undergird Russia and China that they've been interested in are the Muslims and the Serbs. And that's why they went in to blast Serbia and its civilian infrastructure. They wanted to antagonize the Serbian people, and it had a marvelous effect. In Russia, you know, after the phony fall of the Soviet Union, the Americans were popular. You could go over there and everybody loved you. And after the Serbia bombing, all the Russians hated the Americans. It turned them around like crazy. Now, in the Middle East, I want to caution that while they're trying to antagonize the Muslims by these constant interventions, it is not intended, and they are intending to attack Iran, it is not going to lead to World War III. That is, Russia and China simply are not ready to get sucked into World War III. That's why I can guarantee you that Russia will not step in and stop the U.S. and NATO from taking down Syria. They will not stop Iran from being taken down, even though I think they're goading Ahmadinejad into excessive confidence. There's only one thing to explain why he just rants and raves and antagonizes the world. I mean, it's like I'm trying to pick a fight. You can't take us down. He's bragging he must have somebody whispering in his ear and saying, you know, say what you want, we'll protect you.
Well, all the numbers show that the mullahs who are unpopular, if they get attacked, it's going to give them another 20 years of power.
Yeah. But in any case, when they're going to get attacked, the problem is what the Americans don't know is the U.S. and Israel plan to obliterate the infrastructure of Iran so that they don't have to occupy. An occupation in Iran is not in the cards. Be very difficult to pull off and get American support, very costly. I think they're just going to obliterate the infrastructure, military, not just nuclear facilities. It'll start with a nuclear facility to attack. Iran will retaliate against U.S. troops and Israel, and the U.S. will then have an excuse to go in and put its full firepower against Iran. But remember, the main reason here is to rearrange the entire chess pieces of the Middle East, and suddenly the only two powers there will be Israel and the United States. You'll have puppet regimes significantly around them. I think Israel and Libya will continue to be thorns in the side justifying our military presence there. That's why they put Muslim Brotherhood in power in Egypt, to have instability, not stability. And it will continue to be unstable in Libya as well. But ultimately, in the game plan, we have to remember the main target of all of this intervention is to create an image of the U.S. as the bully of the world so that Russia and China can someday be justified in attacking the West. And obviously, there'll be false flag events created by Russia into the Balkans and the former Soviet states against the millions of Russians that they put into those countries specifically so that they have an excuse, like Hitler did, have an excuse to come in and save their own Russian people from NATO and U.S. intervention. But ultimately, I think that North Korea is being preserved to be the trigger for World War III. I think the U.S. will have to use tactical nuclear weapons to stop the huge army of the North Koreans from invading the South, and that will justify Russia and China from saying, U.S. guilty of first use, we can nuke. And they'll do a preemptive strike on America, which I believe our own government is prepared to absorb, not retaliate against, and thus create a destruction wave upon us militarily, not civilian targets, but military targets.
And the globalists are always wanting to abort, quote, minority groups and stuff while posing as liberals. I also see all the urban centers getting destroyed as a good way for the eugenicist to reduce population. From your research, I mean, all my research points towards the Anglo-American establishment being eugenics, Luciferian-based at its core. What is your analysis, Joel Skousen, of the overall mindset of the technocrats?
There is a eugenics agenda, to be sure. There's Memo 200 that Kissinger and others were involved and about eugenics, and they do intend to kill a lot of people in this war, but I don't think that they're going to be able to induce the Russians and Chinese to strike civilian targets. I think that the social unrest, you know, if you strike military targets, which will involve a dozen cities, at least in the United States, such as Seattle, Colorado Springs, San Diego, California, Norfolk, Virginia, Washington, D.C., you know, we have all these integral military targets with civilians, you're going to have enough destruction combined with an EMP strike that it's going to be total social unrest in the United States for at least 6 months. And that's enough to cause, you know, real destruction within the cities without being viewed as the bullies themselves.
Sure. Briefly, you know, you talk about the Muslim infiltration that's the boogeyman while the government runs the Sunni arm of that. There's no doubt. Not so much the Shiite run by Iran. But I have dealt with these Gen 21 people for now about 14 years since I discovered that angle. People I know knew about it before I did, but I personally discovered it. And what I learned is these are not just well-meaning dupes that also make money off power grabs. These are soldiers. The UN is operating inside the U.S. They're taking over all the small towns. They come in with HUD money. They even sit there. I've seen them, you know, with hand codes. I've seen them with Delphi technique. I mean, I know a military or intelligence operation when I see one. And people don't talk about infiltration. It's globalist infiltration of every institution. They are everywhere, crawling all over everything, trying to destroy our infrastructure and make us dependent. While the government itself digs in, like you said, if you look at the architecture of it, for a large nuclear attack to then reemerge with all the high-tech weapons and the rest of it.
That's right. I believe the high-tech weapons are being preserved not to defend America against Russia and China, but to be brought out later and given to a militarized New World Order in order to prosecute the war. And I do believe that the only way that the West will win the war is they cut a deal with China to attack Russia's rear. And the reason that's important, strategy-wise, is that then as the war winds down and Russia is defeated, because it's actually got a lot of weakness, a lot of alcoholism, a lot of problems in there. It doesn't have an economy that can sustain itself without milking, you know, Europe and other countries. But when China attacks its rear on there, then the New World Order has an excuse to say, we have to maintain our militarized global government because we have a new Cold War enemy, China. So you see, they cut a deal just like they cut a deal with Russia. Russia attacks, it helps us defeat Hitler, and then what happens? Russia becomes the new Cold War.
Sure, well,
enemy.
It's come out a bunch that in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, there were deals back and forth where you know, the Russians came and said, nuke China with us, but the U.S. said no, then made the deal in the 70s with Ambassador Bush, and these deals do flip back and forth.
That's absolutely right. So that's how I view the big scenario that we're headed for a takedown.
And by the way, that was declassified, what, about a year ago? It was even in the British papers. For people that know, we're not just saying this. The United States was approached by Russia, and they said, let's make a deal and nuke China. So that shows how these power blocks think. And the United States said no.
Well, the important point to realize is that as we, you and I, Alex, and others fight for our liberty, we have to prepare for a takedown. I'm really not sure we're going to beat these boys the way that, you know, this election is going to be very important.
Well, stay there. Let's break it down.
Have you ever wanted to jump?
Yeah, there's the London Telegraph. USSR planned nuclear attack on China in 1969. The Soviet Union was on the brink of launching a nuclear war against China in 69, only backed down after the U.S. told Moscow such a move would start World War III, according to Chinese historian. Yeah, and they've declassified that, but it's also come out in our news. And if you read deeper, actually, the Russians came to the U.S. and said, make a deal with us, but instead the U.S. went and did a deal with China. And you saw this in World War II, World War I. This is how geopolitical strategy goes on. Joel, talking about not beating the globalist, I just hope people realize that governments worldwide are digging in like they're about to have a nuclear war, and Russia threatened to use nukes over the Georgia thing in 2008. I mean, when you actually read Pentagon, you know, reports, they say the world's more dangerous than it's ever been, and you know, they do talk about China and Russia. And, of course, the fleets have been massing and the troops and bases, you know, in the Pacific more and more. So that's the future. And Al-Qaeda is a literal cutout, but it's religious to freak out and get scared of Muslims. And, you know, I'm not saying there isn't sometimes some radicals or whatever. You know, the point is the government, if you hate Muslims, folks, is bringing them in at record numbers. It is a literal paper tiger. But, I mean, here's Al-Qaeda working for the government. I mean, I want my freedom back. And they use Al-Qaeda as the set piece to take all my freedom, and it's just an asinine fraud, Joel.
That's right, and you can't underestimate how they know how to read the Christian mentality. They've got a biblical feeling for the restoration of Israel, and so they get them to support the Israeli government, which is cares nothing for the biblical Zionism of the Bible of restoring the 10 tribes to, or the 12 tribes to Israel. They're all interested. I mean, the Israeli government is globalist. Benjamin Netanyahu is the Kissinger protege. His whole education was paid for, and he got his first jobs by the Kissinger people. I mean, this is not someone who cares about religion. And but, you know, you can sucker a lot of Christians into supporting the war on terror because of Israel. And you let Israel get a free pass to do anything. I mean, when they attacked Lebanon in the last war, they went after civilian infrastructure. It was just unconscionable.
Well, I mean, now they say, hey, have a drone kill 200 people to get one bad guy. And it's obviously meant to cause a civil war in Pakistan. I mean, it is outrageous.
And that's why you do the double tap. I mean, you're not going to get any more terrorists sticking around after you've thrown a weapon in there. You're going to hit rescue workers and family members trying to help their wounded. It's just unconscionable. The U.S. is antagonizing. And as I say, that has a globalist perspective. I mean, there are other reasons to capture oil, to keep that oil away from China. That's the same thing they played against Japan. I've cut off the oil supply to force them to attack Pearl Harbor. FDR had a six-point plan to antagonize Japan. They're doing the same thing to China. And they're trying to induce Russia. Russia doesn't need any motivation. They've always intended to strike the West. The fall of the Soviet Union was a carefully crafted deception to get the West to give aid and trade and infiltrate
Europe. Look at the EU. Have you seen the new EU symbol that's got the hammer and sickle in it?
I haven't seen that.
Yeah, they've put out a new star showing all these symbols of Europe, and there's hammers and sickles all over it.
Well, of course, Turkey has that, too, and going back to their, you know, Marxist days and things. But believe me, the war isn't imminent. It's going to take at least 8 to 10 years for China and Russia to rebuild their blue water navy, which they don't dare start a world war unless they've got that capability. But we're going to see intermediate wars. We're going to see Iran as a major war. We're going to see rearrangement of the Middle East. But watch out for North Korea and watch out for Russia coming back into the Baltic states and the Soviet states and antagonizing and working with them. They're always going to continue to build their military. Right now they have huge underground missile factories in the Almanto Mountain. The U.S. has never inspected there, yet we give them a clean bill of health and claim that they are in compliance with all the treaties that they made, and they've complied with none of them, Alex. It's a complete fraud. And the only reason to explain this is not that these people are...
Hold on, let's do five more with Joel Skousen and get the DVD, Strategic Relocation, at Infowars.com. You know, I've been running liners like that for 16 years about deep behind globalist occupied the United States. And people used to think it was a joke. Now they know it's not. I mean, I'm in FEMA Region 6. We're not going to get our country back if we don't admit how much trouble we're in. And we've had criminal, corporate, globalist, sophisticated groups come in and use our money and our taxes to build their world government. And now you've got three big power blocks with the Anglo-American, you know, EU, U.S., England, New World Order system trying to fight with the Russians, the Chinese, allied with each other, trying to use the Chinese labor to leverage out the U.S. I mean, it's a very sophisticated model, but at its base, it's about pure evil. You know, Joel, I'm interested on your view. People can get Strategic Relocation 3rd Edition. They can get the film Strategic Relocation, The Secure Home. I mean, people are crazy if they don't. Some people think, well, I'm not going to move to the country, so why does it matter? Well, you've got maps of each city, escape routes. I mean, it's really a masterful job with the film and the book, Joel. But in closing, studying the New World Order, I mean, I know you cover mainly political stuff because, you know, people can spin things if you talk about it. But studying Bohemian Grove, Skull and Bones, when I've studied these people, they really are lovers of death, lovers of raw power, haters of innocence. I mean, look at all the pedophile scandals coming out all over the place. This is like what we see in the Bible. And I think good people, I'm not saying I'm perfect, but I mean, I would never imagine such things. It's not a temptation. It makes me want to vomit. Those of us that are not just given to evil, you know, from birth or whatever it is, because I see some people where it really is just they are evil inherently. We are blind, so many of us, to the real evil we're facing. Can you close with 3-minute comment on that?
Yes, it's important to understand, as I've written in Strategic Relocation, where I give a map of how this conspiracy works, how the globalists work. The ones that are really satanically connected, and that's very real, are at the very top. They use a variety of incentives to keep other people on board. They use predictable minions. They use predictable leftists and people who are yes men. They have an enforcer class in the dark side of the CIA, dark side of the FBI. They have the class that's most visible. I call them the second level directors, and those are people like Henry Kissinger, Brunt Scowcroft, Strobe Talbot, Zbigniew Brzezinski. These are the people we see often. They talk about globalism. But it's important to understand that there's a wide variety of types of people, and not all of them understand, and that's part of how they keep the secret. They don't tell everybody.
Compartmentalization.
That's right, compartmentalization. But it's a very real threat, and that's why I have this dual track in my own career. I try to fight to save our country and alert people to the conspiracies that are going on. I mean, we're not going to save ourselves with electing a Republican. Even if Ron Paul got elected, you know, they might even kill him. It's very difficult for someone to get inside and capture the surveillance machinery that we would need to prosecute and find out and get evidence on these conspiracies. And they're just very, very powerful. That's why we have to be ready for a takedown. We have to be ready for war. If we're going to rebuild a society, Alex, afterwards, a libertarian society, a conservative society with real values, And I think there's going to be a real rearranging. I think God is going to drive people out from among the major cities through crisis, and they'll tend to congregate in further into the West, places where people are known to be gathering, and I think people will be inspired to do that. I think it's an inevitable process that we'll be able to reform, refight against this new world order. At least that's, you know, the backup plan that I feel. I think the establishment's going to try to elect Obama. They don't want Romney in there. That's why, for the first time, I am recommending my subscribers that in swing states, that they go ahead and vote for Romney. But in red states, solidly red states, where Romney is not in danger of losing, vote for third party. We've got to build a third party movement.
Sure.
In powerful blue states, vote for a third party so that we send a message that third parties are on the rise. We've got to break this two-party mentality.
Joel Skousen, thank you so much. By the way, we got contacted by Ron Paul yesterday. He wants to come on. He's on next week. We'll make that announcement further. Joel Skousen, thank you so much. Great job here on the show. I hope everyone will get the new film at InfoWarsStore.com, Strategic Relocation. Give it to your family as a gift and the magazine. Wake people up. Every mind we free is key in this battle against evil. God bless you all.